Okay, 2 weeks ago, I don't really know all that went on last week in talking about Abraham. Hold on, I'm here. I'm seeing two Scots coming in. Oh. But in 2 weeks ago, we did a flyover of Genesis chapter 1 through chapter 11, from creation to Abraham. And we saw there that the eternal God, that he created all things in the beginning, meaning during the creation week, the 6 days of the creation week, which was the beginning of the universe and the existence of all things other than God. And upon completion of creation, it is pronounced, it's referred to as good, 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 good throughout, and then it's pronounced upon creation, very good. It was an idyllic and blessed existence. There was no death, and all things were functioning in the way God desired. But soon, as you know, Satan used a serpent to tempt mankind into sinning against God. And the sin plague that Adam and Eve introduced into the human realm, into the physical world we inhabit, it intensified and it spread, as we saw in Genesis, so that the very good creation was thoroughly and totally corrupted. And as a result, God judged the world in his holy and righteous wrath by bringing a cataclysmic worldwide flood that killed all people and all air-breathing land animals and birds. But in his mercy, he spared righteous Noah and his family and the animals and birds that accompanied them on the ark. And we spent a fair amount of time on that. We saw, though, that sin came through the flood. With Noah and his family, it came into the new post-flood world, which reveals the depth and the extent of sin's grip on mankind. And despite this opportunity that God had provided for a new beginning for mankind, we continued in our rebellion, continued in our sin. And so, that raises this question. As I said 2 weeks ago, this creation that we experience is not the way it's supposed to be. It's no longer a paradise where all things are functioning in peace and harmony under the rule of God. Instead, it's a creation that's infected with things like anger and hatred and division and violence and destruction and disease and decay and lying and stealing and suffering and sorrow and pain. That's the world we live in. And it's not the way it's supposed to be. It is a fallen world, and the flood demonstrates for us that God cannot rescue his creation simply by killing off sinners, because sin has infected everyone. So you see that message in the flood. It's a message for us. It is God's holy and just and righteous wrath against sin. But there's also this message that says, do you see how deep the problem is? Clearly some kind of extraordinary work was going to be required to heal the sin-sick world, to restore the broken creation that it might be all that God intends it to be. And we see that work beginning to take shape with the call of Abraham. Abram first, and he's later called Abraham. You see that in Genesis chapter 12. God calls this man. God elects this man and calls this man, Abram. And he promises to bless him with a great multitude of descendants, living securely in a bountiful and blessed homeland. As I mentioned, that becomes a symbol of something. But a great multitude of descendants living securely in a bountiful and blessed homeland. And he promises to bless all nations through him. And this veiled statement that we looked at in Genesis chapter 3, verse 15, that a man, a descendant of Eve, would win the ultimate victory over Satan, it is now narrowed by God in this election of Abraham. Of all the people of all the nations, the Messiah who would bless the world through the defeat of Satan is going to come in the lineage of this one man, Abraham. So we have these nations, these people, and God calls this one man. And through him, all the nations of the earth will be blessed. Well, I can't dwell on Abraham, Isaac, or Jacob, because the lesson today is to be about Joseph. But note that the family line of the Messiah, it's further traced through Abraham's son Isaac. So not only of all the people in the world we have Abraham, but we have of the descendants is going to be Isaac, through whom the Messiah is going to come. In Genesis chapter 26, 4, it says, "In your offspring all nations of the earth shall be blessed." And this blessing will come through Isaac's son Jacob, as it says in Genesis 28, 14, "In you and your offspring shall all the families of the earth be blessed." Okay, let's look at Joseph. That'll occupy the rest of the class. As most of you know, Isaac's son Jacob, he had by exploitation and deception, he had taken from his older twin brother Esau both the birthright, which is the disproportionate inheritance to which the eldest son is entitled. He had by exploitation and deception taken from Esau both the birthright and the blessing. And that refers to the covenant blessing, the privilege of being the child of promise. So Esau is intent on killing him. And so Jacob had done that. Esau's intent on killing him, but to protect Jacob, his mother Rebekah, she manipulated Isaac into sending Jacob to her brother Laban in Haran to find a wife. Let's see if I got that little... Okay, so she said, no, you send him up there, he'll find a wife up there. But she's doing that to protect him from Esau. Now, there is much that happens to Jacob in and on the way to and from Haran that we have to skip over. Okay, I just don't have time to go into all that. But while he was in Haran, Jacob had six sons and one daughter by his wife Leah. He had two sons by Leah's servant Zilpah. He had two sons by Rachel's servant Bilhah. And finally, he has a son by his beloved wife Rachel. Now, when Rachel gives birth to this son, she says in Genesis 30, 23, "God has taken away my reproach." And she named the son Joseph. And in doing that, she says, "May the Lord add to me another son." And the name Joseph means, "May he add." So here, Rachel finally has a son. And she says, names him Joseph, saying, "May God add to me another son." Now, after Joseph was born, you can see the down trip now. You see, coming down this way. After Joseph was born, Jacob worked for his uncle for another 6 years. He works for his uncle Laban another 6 years. And then, in accordance with God's directive, he moves the family back to his homeland, back to the promised land. And it was on that journey back to the promised land that Jacob is given the name Israel. Okay, so you know Jacob and Israel, the same person, right? You've got sons of Jacob, they are the sons of Israel. So Jacob and Israel, he's given that name there. And the Lord did indeed grant Rachel another son, but that was after the family had returned to Canaan. See, as they traveled from Shechem to Ephrath, which is Bethlehem, the family's traveling there. Well, Rachel dies outside of Ephrath, giving birth to Jacob's 12th son, Benjamin. And then the family continues on down to Hebron, where Jacob's father Isaac was still living at the time. As I said, much happens going to in Haran and on the way that we're skipping. But this is the Reader's Digest version of what's happening, because I'm getting down to the story of Joseph. Now, Joseph, the story of Joseph occupies roughly the last quarter of the book of Genesis, from Genesis 37 through the end of Genesis. It begins there in 37, and we're told that Joseph, who at the age of 17, he's tending Jacob's flock with his older brothers. He's there with those other brothers, or he's helping those other brothers, and they're identified as the sons of Bilhah, which would be Dan and Naphtali, and the sons of Zilpah, which would be Gad and Asher. So he's there with those four brothers, and something happens there. He becomes aware of some kind of conduct on the part of his brothers that he felt obligated to report to his father. Now, that event is probably, there's some debate about why that's there and how it functions, but it's probably there to provide an opening glimpse of young Joseph's character, that he was a dutiful son who puts faithfulness to his father above popularity with his brothers. You know, that's not an easy thing to do. So you get this glimpse of him there. Now, Jacob, or Israel, as you probably know, he loved Joseph more than his other sons. And Scripture says it was because he was a son of Jacob's old age. That was true of Benjamin also. But it says he loves Joseph more than all the sons. And they were, see, Joseph and Benjamin were, they were the last two sons born to Jacob. Those two born to Rachel. They're sons of his beloved Rachel. And Rachel had been barren until Jacob's later years. Now, you say, well, what about Benjamin? I mean, what you have Joseph being born as the 11th son, Rachel's son. You have Benjamin being born as Joseph's 12th son, Rachel's son. Why is Joseph, the 11th son, the favorite son? Both of them were sons of Jacob's old age. Well, I suspect that the reason is that Rachel died during the birth of Benjamin, and that probably left a bad taste. It mixed some bitterness in there. But that's not spelled out. But we have Joseph now. Jacob made his favoritism of Joseph, he makes it open and obvious by making for Joseph this special and distinctive coat. Okay? Now, whether the robe was multicolored, whether it was richly ornamented, whether it simply had long sleeves, there's debate about that. Precisely what is the nature of this robe? But it clearly is something that is special and distinctive. And it was a visual testimony of Jacob's preference for Joseph. And as a result of this blatant favoritism that Jacob has for Joseph, this blatant favoritism that Joseph's brothers, they hated him so intensely they couldn't even speak kindly to him. They were just really, this guy drives us crazy. You see, and that's rooted in this blatant favoritism. And their hatred for Joseph, it was only magnified. When he tells them this dream that he had, and they're all out binding sheaves in the field. And he says, yeah, you know, my dream, my sheaf stood up, and all of yours bowed to it. Well, you can see that didn't endear him to them. You see, he says, so that just fueled their hatred for him. And when he told his fathers and his brothers about another dream, he says, went to the sun and moon and the 11 stars were bowing down to him. He told them that, and then even his father wasn't really pleased with him airing the idea that they would all bow down before him. He didn't care for that. But interestingly, in Genesis chapter 37, verse 11, it says, and his brothers were jealous of him, but his father kept the saying in mind. He didn't care for it. He didn't like hearing that, but he said, I wonder if something's up. You know, I wonder if there's something going on here. Well, one day, Jacob, he sends Joseph out to check on his brothers. Okay, they're out tending Jacob's flock in Shechem. So he says, you go ahead out there and, you know, just check on them and see how everything is going. So he sends them out there, but Joseph learns, well, they're actually in Dothan, which is 14 miles to the north. So he goes ahead and he greets them, meets them there. That's where he carries on and follows them there. He went there to them. But his brothers, they spot him, whether it's the distinctive coat he's wearing or whatever. But they spot him when he's a long way off. And they decided they're going to kill him. You see, you know, here we have the sons of Israel. They're going to kill him. And they're going to throw him in a cistern. Now, a cistern was simply a place for storing water. They'd dig down into a limestone and then they'd plaster it. And that's where you could store water. So they're going to throw him in this cistern. They're going to kill him and toss his body there. But Reuben, who's the eldest son, he persuades them. He says, no, let's not do that. Let's just throw him into the cistern and keep him there, as you know, hold him in prison. You know, let's just do that. Instead of killing him and throwing his body there, he convinces them to do that. Presumably, he tells them, listen, that'll give us more time to figure out what we really want to do. Now, Reuben's planning to rescue his brother from this cistern. So he says, just throw him in there. That'll be like a holding tank. That'll, you know, maybe he's telling them, that'll give us more time. We can really think about this and see what we want to do. His plan, he's going to, in fact, rescue him. So when Joseph arrives, they strip him of his hated robe and they toss him into this empty cistern. Now, unfortunately for Reuben's rescue plan, his brother Judah. He sees a caravan of Ishmaelites / Midianites. The people fit both descriptions, so don't get hung up on that. But the Ishmaelites / Midianites, he sees this caravan coming, heading to Egypt, and he persuades the brothers, here's what we ought to do. Look, I mean, we can turn this into something, you know, why just kill him? We'll turn it into a prophet. So let's sell our brother in slavery to these people going down to Egypt. And so he convinces his brothers that's what they're going to do. And then to cover their evil deed, they slaughter a goat. And they take this distinctive robe of Joseph's, they dip it in the goat's blood, and then they take it to the father as proof that he'd been devoured by an animal. Now, isn't that a cruel thing to do? Can you imagine going to somebody and say, hey, by the way, listen, I was just out on the street and I saw your child get run over. Your child's dead. Oh, man, that's brutal. Well, this is what they do. And they wind up, you know, so they do that, that this animal had devoured him. Well, the Ishmaelites / Midianites, they sold Joseph to Potiphar. Potiphar is this high-ranking official, officer of Pharaoh. And in Genesis chapter 39, it recounts that by the Lord's blessing, Joseph rises to prominence in Potiphar's house. That's pretty amazing, isn't it? I mean, here's this guy, his brothers sell him into slavery. These guys come and they sell him to Potiphar. Next thing you know, he's rising to prominence because the Lord is at work blessing him. So he rises to prominence in Potiphar's house. He wound up being in charge of Potiphar's entire household. He was trusted with everything. Now, that's the kind of person you want, somebody you can trust so much. I give you power over everything. You run my affairs so I don't have to worry about it, because I have that much confidence in you. And so that's where Joseph was, his station in life. Now, Joseph, he was a well-built and handsome young man, it says in Genesis 39, verse 6. Something like my brother. You see, a well-built and handsome young man. You see? And after a while, Potiphar's wife, well, she flat out propositioned him when they were alone in the house. I mean, no, you know, subtle seduction, none of that. She just flat out propositions him when they're in the house. Now, this is a real test of faithfulness. This is a real test of faithfulness. Given that he was a young, unmarried man, and given how that come on would have stoked the male ego, I'm certain as a dude, that there was part of him that would have loved to hop in bed with this woman. You see, there was part of him that would have loved to have done that. It would have been a tremendous temptation. All of that physical pleasure, and it would have been their little secret. All of this, and she would have been culpable, so she wouldn't have had any reason to let the cat out of the bag. So it would just be our little secret. And so I know this is a tremendous temptation, and it's because I feel sure the temptation would have been so great that I so much admire the response that we see in Genesis 39, verses 8 and 9. Behold, this is Joseph's response. Behold, because of me, my master has no concern about anything in the house, and he has put everything that he has in my charge. He's not greater in this house than I am. Nor has he kept back anything from me except you, because you're his wife. How then can I do this great wickedness and sin against God? Oh, man. Now here is a living faith in God. This is a living faith in God. You see, a faith that dictates conduct. It's not simply abstract, I think this, but it doesn't feed into my life. I think this, but it has no bearing on my life. No, I think this, and that controls how I live. And that's what this is. This is a living faith that dictates his conduct despite how much part of him may have wanted to do wrong, and despite the fact his sin would go undiscovered by other people. However strong that urge was, his faith in God dictated how he would live. He refused to break faith with God. He refused to break faith with God. That commitment to God trumped all else. I will not dishonor God, and I will not break faith with him. Oh, I know, you know, I can imagine, but I'm not doing it because I belong to him. You see, that is a living faith there. That is a living faith. And as that song goes, Lord, give us such a faith as this. This is something here. Now, this wasn't a one-shot deal, by the way. Genesis chapter 39, verse 10, it says that Potiphar's wife pressed him day after day. You see, trying to break down his resistance, trying to seduce him, all of her feminine wiles being poured onto this guy. And he's a young, unmarried man. And so this wasn't a one-shot deal, but Joseph wouldn't listen to her. He said, no, I belong to him. I belong to him. And that's dictating how I live in this world. That's dictating how I live in this world. Well, one day when they're alone in the house, Potiphar's wife, she grabbed Joseph's garment, literally grabs the guy and pulls on him and says, lie with me. Lie with me. Well, Joseph, he just takes off. He takes off and literally runs from the house, leaving his garment in her hand. Well, as the saying goes, hell hath no fury like a woman scorned. Okay? Well, she then, of course, she winds up falsely accusing Joseph of having tried to rape her. This is no minor thing. She says, yeah, look, I got the garment here. He took off, he tried to rape me, and when I screamed, he fled in such a hurry, he left his coat. Here's the proof, he tried to rape me. And so Potiphar throws Joseph in prison. Now, the fact he didn't have him killed may be an indication that he's a wee bit suspicious of his wife's story. Or it may simply be an indication that the Lord protected Joseph. But in any event, he throws Joseph into prison. Now, Joseph, he certainly wasn't in a position to defend himself. When you think about it, you say, well, why didn't Joseph just come out and come clean and tell him everything? He's in no position to defend himself. It would be his word against Potiphar's wife. And accusing a man's wife of unfaithfulness with no proof is not really a wise idea, all the more so when you're a foreign slave in a country and he's a powerful guy. You see, there's really not a whole lot in that for you. It's not going to turn out well for you. You're going to be viewed as compounding things. Now, you can imagine that being thrown in prison after having honored God by resisting this temptation, this powerful temptation, you can imagine that might be a blow to Joseph's faith, right? I mean, think of it. He's sitting here, wow, you know, Lord, because I love you, I honor you, I'm not going to do this wicked thing. How can I sin against God this way? Come on, Joseph. Lie with me. No, I'm not going to do it. Okay, next he's in prison. Can you see how that might, you know, disturb his faith? You know, you might think that would wind up having some kind of effect on his faith. You see? That this would occur. But you know, Joseph's faith is deeper than that. His faith is deeper than that. It trusts God even when he acts in ways that he and we can't comprehend. Even when he acts in ways, you think, well, listen, I honored you here, so there ought to be something coming down the road here for me. Prison. Ooh. That's what's in the road for you, prison. You see, so, but he has a faith that he holds to that. See, even when it's unclear what God is doing. Indeed, his faithfulness in the matter of Potiphar's wife, this was after he'd been sold into slavery, right? And this is before the outlines of God's larger work, what he's doing, come into view. He can't look at that and say, okay, all right, I get it. Okay, I see what... No! All he knows is it makes no sense. I honor you and I'm this person, and next thing I know, I'm in prison. And this is where so much of the struggle of faith happens in life. See, between my state of suffering and my understanding of its role in any larger plan, in any larger picture, can I continue to trust that God has me in His hand when I cannot see what He possibly can be doing? When it looks chaotic, when it looks like He's not in control, can I continue to trust that God has me in His hand in that kind of situation? See, suffering in that dark space, that tests a person's faith like little else. Suffering in that dark space where I cannot make sense of what is happening to me. But by God's blessing, Joseph is eventually, he's put in charge of the prisoners. You see, just as he'd risen to prominence in Potiphar's house, he gets thrown in jail. What happens? He rises to prominence in jail. He's put in charge of the prisoners. And then Pharaoh's chief baker and chief cupbearer, they're thrown, it just so happens they're thrown into Joseph's prison. Now, one night they both have dreams, which Joseph interpreted for them, and he tells the cupbearer, he says, your dream means that in 3 days you're going to be restored to your position as cupbearer. And he says, by the way, when that happens, will you go ahead and tell Pharaoh that I'm innocent? Okay? He tells the baker, your dream means that in 3 days you'll be hanged. Not the best news to deliver. But he says, in 3 days you'll be hanged. And both of these interpretations come to pass, but the cupbearer forgets to tell Pharaoh. 2 years later. 2 years. He continues in this prison, and 2 years later, Pharaoh has a couple of troubling dreams that no one can interpret. Pharaoh's got these dreams. So the cupbearer says, oh yeah. Well, now that you bring up the issue of dreams, this guy in prison, Joseph, you know, I had a dream, and the baker had a dream, and he interpreted both of them accurately. Pharaoh says, okay. Joseph, he sends to prison for Joseph, and then Joseph, by revelation of God, he tells Pharaoh about his dreams. And he tells Pharaoh, he says, the dreams meant that there were coming 7 years of abundance, all kinds of crops and everything, you know, good times are rolling. And then there's going to be followed by 7 years of famine. And Joseph suggests to Pharaoh that he initiate a grain conservation and storage program so that he would have grain during the famine. He says, look, because of this dream and the interpretation, you're now given insight into what the future holds. So plan for it. So here's what you ought to do. You go ahead and store up during the plenty, and so when the famine comes, you're sitting fat. Those are my words, but that's the idea. You see, you're sitting fat. So Pharaoh likes that idea, and he puts Joseph in charge of the project. Now, how would you think this slave being sold, this guy being sold into slavery by his brothers, this Jew, he now winds up in charge of Pharaoh's project? Now, Pharaoh does that, you see, because Pharaoh realizes that God was granted, because of Joseph's ability to interpret these dreams that's given to him by God, he realizes that God was granting him extraordinary discernment and wisdom. So why not put him in charge? Who better? Who better? So he puts Joseph in charge. Now, Joseph was 30 years old at that time, and he's given an Egyptian name, Zaphnath-Paneah, and he's given an Egyptian wife. And then he travels around Egypt storing up grain in anticipation of the years of famine. See, which was his advice to Pharaoh, that Pharaoh said, yeah, I like that idea. So he winds up doing that. And then when the famine hits, it's so bad that people in the entire region were coming to Egypt to buy grain from Joseph. All over the place. And in Genesis chapter 42, Jacob sends his sons except Benjamin. You see, Joseph, son 11, Benjamin, son 12, both of those by Rachel. Joseph, as far as he knows, has been eaten by an animal. He says, you know, I'm not sending Benjamin. So he sends the 10 other sons to Egypt to buy grain. And not surprisingly, they don't recognize Joseph as their brother. Because how can that be true? Come on, man. It had been years since they've seen him. He's speaking through an interpreter. And it's in a completely bizarre context where they'd never think that that's their brother. I don't even recognize people when I see them in the grocery store. Are you thinking about Pharaoh's right-hand man speaking through an interpreter? All right, so that's another thing people say that makes a little sense. All right, so they don't recognize him. And then Joseph, he manipulates the situation to get them to bring Benjamin. Joseph has something in mind, I think, what he's doing. But he manipulates the situation to get them to bring me. He tells them, look, you know, first he said, you guys are spies. He says, no, we're not spies. No, no, we're all the sons of, you know, one man, and we got a baby brother back there with him in Canaan. And he says, oh, yeah? He said, all right, here's what we'll do. To prove you're not spies, you bring that baby brother, so you say, you bring him here. And we'll have a little examination, of course. You don't have to say that, but we'll find out if that's really your baby brother. And we'll find out then if you are spies or if you're in fact telling me the truth. Now, I think what he's doing, he's looking to see if from what they had done to him, he's looking to see if they had learned anything about the bond of brotherhood. And if they'd learned anything about what it means to love their father. You see, were they now different? Were they now the kind of people with whom he could be reconciled? Or would they treat Rachel's only other son, Benjamin, with the same lack of love they had shown him? And would they do the same kind of thing to their father and again break his heart? He's trying to see, have they learned anything from this so that now they're the kind of people with whom I can be reconciled? Well, Benjamin is eventually, much struggle there, but Benjamin is eventually brought back to Egypt. They say, okay, they all get all their grain, everything. Okay, see you guys on the way. But he has one of his guys, says, here, you put this silver cup in Benjamin's sack. Okay, so he sends them all off, and he says, you guys go out there, and you catch them, and then, you know, search the sacks, find the silver cup, and then bring them all back here as thieves. So that's what he does. He goes, they look, they find, wow, the silver cup, what do you know? We're not stealing anything from him. Well, love, what is this? Benjamin's got a silver cup in his bag. So what kind of stuff is this? Here I do you a solid, and you steal from me? And so he brings them all back, you see, under the accusation that they'd stolen from him, and Joseph told him, he says, okay, here's what we'll do. All right, this thing's only in Benjamin's sack, so here's what we'll do. All of you guys can go, but Benjamin stays here with me as a slave. Okay, does that sound good? You guys can go. But Benjamin stays here with me as a slave. Then Judah, the very brother who'd conceived the idea to sell Joseph into slavery, he begged Joseph to take him instead of Benjamin because his father could not take the loss of his only other son by Rachel. So here you have Judah saying, take me as a slave instead. Take me as a slave in place of Benjamin, you see. Now, Joseph now saw, you see, that his brothers, he now sees them in light of that. He sees them as men with whom he could be reconciled. Men who had learned that Rachel's sons were no less their brothers and they were no less precious to their father and should not be treated otherwise. So he now sees from Judah's action, contrasted to how he'd acted toward him, that they're now people with whom he could be recognized. Judah was willing to be a slave. Willing to be a slave rather than allow the fate of slavery to befall Benjamin. And that's quite a turnaround, isn't it? And that's quite a turnaround from the person who orchestrated Joseph's sale into slavery. So Joseph, at that point, he orders everybody out. And then in this tremendously emotional moment, he reveals himself to his brothers. It's just amazing. Now, Joseph's deep faith in God is perhaps nowhere better exemplified than in the statement he makes to his brothers in Genesis 45, verses 5 through 8. He says, "And now do not be distressed or angry with yourselves because you sold me here. For God sent me before you to preserve life. For the famine has been in the land these 2 years, and there are yet 5 years in which there will be neither plowing nor harvest." They have no grocery stores to go to. No fries, none of that. He says, "And God sent me before you to preserve for you a remnant on earth and to keep alive for you many survivors. So it was not you who sent me here, but God. He has made me a father to Pharaoh and lord of all his house and ruler over all the land of Egypt." See, he continued to trust in God through the years when it wasn't clear what God was doing. It wasn't clear when he was sold into slavery. It wasn't clear when he was thrown into prison. What in the world was going on? He was sold as a slave, and then he saw his faithfulness rewarded with years of imprisonment, but he continued to trust that his life was in God's hands when he couldn't see how. He couldn't see what's he doing. But he continued to trust. "Though I can't see, I trust that he has me in his hand." And that's what he continued to do. And when God allowed him to see the pivotal role that he was playing in the preservation of the covenant people, he allowed him to see his faith vindicated. See, when he let him see, "Do you see what I'm doing now?" Oh! He let him see his faith vindicated. You see, God let him see how privileged he was to suffer as an instrument of God's blessing. He let him see that. Now, we often can't see what God's doing in our circumstances, right? I mean, unless your life is different. We often cannot see what God is doing in our circumstances, and we're tempted to doubt he's at work, but we need to hold to him in the darkness. We need to hold to him in the darkness. See, if we are not allowed to see in this life how our struggles fit with God's larger working and his larger plan, we will see it someday. We will see it someday. Now, Jacob and his family, as you know, they settled in Egypt. They all come there and they live under the blessings of Joseph's rule. He's, you know, a father to Pharaoh. They come, they're all blessed. Jacob dies there at age 147. His body's embalmed and is taken to Canaan for interment at the cave of Machpelah in Hebron. And then Joseph dies some 54 years later at the age of 110. Now, as I said, the story of Joseph, it's from Genesis 37 all the way through the end of Genesis, the end of chapter 50. But inserted at Genesis chapter 38 is the seemingly odd story of Judah, one of the brothers, and Tamar, Judah's daughter-in-law. You have this case, you have Genesis 37 through 50, it's the story of Joseph, but stuck right in here is this seemingly odd story. And in brief, we have Judah's Canaanite wife. She bears him 3 sons, Onan, and Shelah. So she bears him 3 sons, and the oldest, marries Tamar. But he's wicked and the Lord puts him to death. And so it's Onan's responsibility then to marry her and to have children so that Ur's line will continue. You see, so that's his responsibility. But he doesn't do that. He's disobedient. And that's his stuff about his spilling his seed on the ground. See, he doesn't want Tamar to have children because he apparently wants that line to end, presumably so he will benefit from it somehow in the inheritance structure. So he does what is wicked in that regard. The Lord puts him to death. So now we've got 2 sons down, no heirs. 2 sons are gone and no heirs. So Judah tells Tamar, "Look, you just wait until the youngest son," and by the way, also having children for Tamar would give her somebody to care for her when she's old. But anyway, Judah tells Tamar, he says, "Listen, wait until my youngest son, Shelah, is old enough to marry you, and then I'll give him to you." But see, after Shelah, he winds up, he's grown up. And when Tamar sees he's grown and he hasn't been given to me as a husband, I see that Judah's, he's going to renege on this deal. I see he has no intention of following through on that. So after Judah's wife died, when he would be particularly vulnerable to sexual temptation, she disguises herself as a prostitute and she's impregnated by Judah without him knowing who she was. So she disguises herself, Judah impregnates her, and then as collateral, she says, listen, he says, I'll bring your payment or whatever. And she says, okay, just to make sure, you give me some personal items, things that I can identify with you, so we'll be sure that you'll make good on your promise to actually come and pay me my fee for my services. Okay, so she has these personal items of his. Well, when it becomes obvious that Tamar is pregnant, you know, that's a scandal. And so Judah's leading the pack, saying she needs to be killed. She needs to be killed. Well, she then lags out these personal items and says, I'm pregnant by the dude who owns these. Ooh. Ooh. I'm pregnant by the guy who owns these. And you see in Genesis 38, 26, Judah confesses, she is more righteous than I, since I did not give her to my son Shelah. See, so that's his confession of his wrong there. Now, I think that that account is there. I think it's there embedded in the Joseph narrative to signal the significance of Judah's lineage. I think that's why it's there. See, the lineage was in jeopardy because you had two sons who'd already been killed. And then you had the third and final son being withheld from his brother's widow, which was an act of defiance of God, which God would hardly bless. So what's going to come of Judah's lineage? You see, but Judah's lineage is preserved despite his wrongdoing by Tamar's action. See, so it's preserved there. Then we see in Genesis 49, end of the book, we see that it's from Judah. It is from Judah that the ruler will come who will defeat the Lord's enemies. You see, in other words, the Messiah, the offspring of the woman who will triumph over the serpent, will be from the line of Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and Judah. You see, so we have this work of this preservation. Who's doing this? Who's working and doing this? So Joseph's preservation of the covenant people, which is really what we see in 37 through 50, that God brings him to this place that he can preserve the covenant people. His preservation of the covenant people is cast as being especially significant in its preservation of the Judah subset of those covenant people. So it's inserted right here at 38. And then in 49, you get this idea of the significance of Judah. I think that's what's going on there. Indeed, in Matthew 1:3, Luke 3:33, they include in the Lord Jesus' genealogy. It includes Perez, one of the twins born by Judah, or that Judah had by Tamar. All right, let me say just a couple other things. I know the bell's going to ring. Notice the time frame of God's working. You know, the song, God Moves in a Mysterious Way, he does indeed. You see, he does indeed. You look at the time frame here. A couple of centuries have elapsed. Centuries! You know, in Mick world, that's unheard of. But a couple of centuries have elapsed from his promise to Abraham, and yet God is working as sure as I'm standing here. He's working. Well, I want him to do it now. You just leave it to him. Do you see? You leave it to him. He's at work. And notice the inscrutability of God's ways, as Paul exclaims in Romans chapter 11, verse 33. I mean, why gather Israel's descendants in Egypt to spare them? Was that second, Bill? Second? I'm still saying this, okay? So then I'll shut up. But why gather them there in Egypt to preserve them from the danger of the famine instead of making it rain where they are? Can God not make it rain where they are? Sure he can. He can make it rain where they are, but you see, God is weaving a tapestry from a perspective that only he has. You and I are embedded in the fibers. And we don't see, what is he doing? You see, and if you can get a grip on that and accept that God is powerfully weaving, even when I'm just too close and embedded and I can't see, you trust that all things are in His hand and He is at work. And I heard that bell, and I'm overtime, but thanks for coming.